Okay, so great. The second part, however you call it. Let me introduce you to you, Pia. We met in Stockholm. He's a real hacker. I mean, real hacker. And I've been looking for an introduction joke. Did you guys see the IT crowd?
Yeah.
No.
No, you didn't. Well, this is the wrong audience to ask this question. I mean, we are all into this shit. So anyway, just look at the table here, what he has here. I probably would say this
the
is
internet.
The internet, exactly.
But it's got no wires.
Exactly. Yeah, it's so, you know.
It's not the internet.
So let's learn from a real good hacker here about whatever it is with all those spaceship lights.
Is it heavy?
Yes.
Oh.
Pretty heavy. 4 kilos. So hello, I'm giving a talk about basically two case studies, basically one case study, this one, the case I brought. The other one is only the end, a short thing, because it's still in progress, so I can't talk too much about it. For one part, I may not talk about it for the other, because it's not done yet. I'm usually working in the embedded world, so I help people build devices and program them, or I build my devices myself. This one is built by my company, basically by me, with some great partners. So let's get into it. So the two cases is the reflashing system. That's a nice blinking light here. This is for automotive embedded control units, shortly ECUs. These are all the small boxes that go into a car. In, like, your dashboard is one, and you have small gray ones that are hidden, or metal ones that are in the engine compartment. And these get more and more software. And actually, there was a research by a big car manufacturer in Munich who tried to estimate how much flashable memory in one car will be in the future. And they found out that if you take the RAM of a well-equipped PC now, then you get the amount of flash memory that needs to be updated in a car in 7 years. So that's a lot. So, and they found out they had to do something, and one part of what they had to do is they don't want to get all software in the car when the car is built. So they want to have the ECUs, which are built all over the world, and which are using pre-programmed CPUs, like where you have to tell the CPU manufacturer eight weeks in front that you want to have a different software. And they have all kinds of delays shipping, real shipping on a ship. And lots of software has also lots of bugs, especially in the startup. I lost my mic. I didn't fix it. I think I got it now. Fixed it. Yes. So where was I? So they have long delays until the actually control unit gets shipped to the car manufacturer and built into the car. And if at this point they have all software in the control unit, they have to reflash the whole car at the end of the line, which is the most expensive place to do this, because we have whole cars standing around waiting, because flashing takes time. And so they don't want this, and the manufacturers of the control units need a solution to reflash stock. So they have like a few thousand control units sitting in a stock close to the assembly line, and they need to reflash it. And they're at the moment, at least as I know of, there is no other solution than this for like a a ready-made solution. You can build like a custom solution for every control unit itself, which they often do if they have their own assembly line close by, because they just run it over their assembly line flasher or something like this. But if you just have a stock and your assembly line is like in Japan, then it doesn't work. So what we need is lots of channels, and we need to talk all these automotive protocols. So I'm getting ahead of myself. Here's some picture, but I have brought one in 3D here because I'm actually living close to Munich and I had to carry it all the way here, not very far. So on the side, this is a two-channel unit. That's because it, you see it has two blinking lights. And the blinking lights are actually very important because the people who actually do the reflashing of thousands of control units, they need it easy. It has to be process safe. So they just look at the blinking lights. They don't look at the screen. The screen is only if something is messed up and you need to like look at the error message, which shouldn't be there any. So basically this thing, when you're flashing, it goes from blue to yellow and then it blinks yellow while it's flashing and then it gets green or red. Green good box, red bad box. So you can take crews for reflashing actions and just train them for 15 minutes and then they can use it. And you need lots of them. So this is just a two-channel unit. The lots of them we get later. That's the automotive protocols, which are in use at the moment. The first one is LIN. It's basically UART with some extras, kind of UART bus for very small control units, like the direction sign or something like that. It's only for very small things. And then there's CAN. Some of you probably have heard of CAN. There's two variants of it, low speed and high speed, which are actually electrically different. Then there's a quite modern one, that's FlexRay. It's a synchronous safety-related bus with 10 megabits. I think 10 megabits at the moment, which you can do drive-by-wire applications with. So you can like have on your joystick steering wheel and the signal goes over FlexRay and it has redundancy and everything built in. Then there is MOST, that's an optical bus, unusually optical bus, which was invented for the whole multimedia in the car. It actually has a frame rate of, it had 44.1, but now it has 48 kilohertz frame rate synchronous, so like CD or DVD. And yeah, we'll see more about MOST later. It's basically the bus they use to wire the car stereo digitally to the speakers or stuff like this. Then very new, right in development at the moment, that's OABR. That's Ethernet with a special physical layer. They do 100 megabit Ethernet over two wire, unshielded, in a car. So they have high EMV standards. Basically, as I understood it, I'm not a hardware developer, I'm a software developer. As I understood it, they use gigabit Ethernet PHYs and program them different, so they only do 100 megabit, but for low EMV. So the data level is Ethernet, but the electrical level is a little bit different. Then there is also APIX, that's also a multimedia bus. It's basically for sending video to the rear seat entertainment system, stuff like this. And there's also Ethernet via APIX. APIX has 3 gigabit per second. APIX 2, up to 3 gigabit per second. So they're doing serious communication protocols in the car, like from very slow to very fast. And actually, the one with a little check mark behind them, that's actually the stuff I already have in the box. So we need to talk all these different communication protocols in all the variants of all car manufacturers, at least if I want to have world domination with the boxes. Yeah. So I started out with BMW because they have lots of software in the car and they're in Munich, and I'm in Munich too. So, but that was 10 years ago, and now I have a box that can flash everything that has four wheels, hopefully. These automotive protocols have some properties which are not so nice for flashing. which are very nice if you have to implement them in very small controllers in the car, but they have some bad things that influence actually the design and how I can use Erlang with the box. Most of the flash processes go over the diagnostic protocol, which is basically the protocol you talk to if the car gets connected in the workshop when they just read out diagnostics and reflash the car over this protocol. That's why they use this protocol. They have actually quite big packets, which have to be broken down if you go down to the buses. Traditionally, it was a serial line in the car with different signals also, called the OBD. Now, the more modern car manufacturers have a 100 megabit Ethernet on this same plug. And they also run the diagnostic protocol over Ethernet. So there are several embeddings for the diagnostic protocol over all these buses you have seen before. And that's the main way I talk to the control units. The bad thing is that's a ping-pong protocol. So no flow control. You send a request and you get an answer and you have to wait for it. And then you can send your next request. So that's actually not so nice. It gets especially weird if you have to map it on like CAN packets, which are very small. Then they have the mappings. They have like a bursty kind of flow control thing. Like you send one packet, like, oh, I would like to send you some data this big, and then it tells you back, okay, you can send me a maximum of 50 packets, and don't send more than this much packets per second. So you can specify an interrupt rate, and you have to really do this, because if you send the packets too fast, if it's a very small control unit, it can't take the packets and it drops them. So that's the next layer. And as you have seen, you have a big variety of physical and link layers, and a variety also in the flashing process between the different car manufacturers. And so you need something very flexible. So let's get back to the box. The hardware of this box is basically, there's a mini ITX mainboard. That's right above here. And it runs FreeBSD.
Why?
Later. and Erlang, I have a slide about FreeBSD, and there's some of the wires on it.
Okay.
And Erlang runs on FreeBSD, and these normal industrial mainboards, they can't talk to all the car manufacturer protocols, and so I have an internal USB switching layer, basically a hub, several hubs cascaded inside the box, and the gateways are using actual the car ECU CPUs, which usually have a bunch of the car manufacturer buses built in. Unfortunately, not USB usually, so you have to use an external USB thing. That's actually high-speed USB, because otherwise I wouldn't have enough bandwidth. Well, there's also Ethernet, but the Ethernet goes out of the box. So, FreeBSD. Yeah, well, I don't like Linux. I use BSD, a commercial BSD from BSDI before Linux was even conceived of. So why should I switch to Linux? I don't know. Okay, I get more device drivers. But I don't like many device drivers with like questionable stability. Okay, everybody who is doing embedded is doing Linux now. Embedded Linux is a big thing, but it's more a buzzword thing. So I like FreeBSD better. The last version of this box I built was OpenBSD, but they got too weird for me. I don't need this security in a box that's not connected to anything. It boots from a compact flash card. There is two partitions for upgrade, so I don't have to run Erlang relapse. I just upgrade the whole operating system, which is actually nice, because I can actually upgrade also the operating system in the same process. So in the configuration is in an extra partition on the on the compact flash and copy it into the RAM disk. And there's an extra partition for logging also. And you get all this for free if you get a standard FreeBSD installation with a NanoBSD build script that comes with FreeBSD. You run it, you get a compact flash image. Easy. Yeah, well, Erlang runs on FreeBSD, and I try to do as much of the automotive protocols as possible in Erlang because of the flexibility and because Erlang really rocks if you want to implement protocols. The protocol layers are actually stackable by config. We will see part of this later. I use libUSB, which is basically a It comes from Linux. It's basically an open source library which exists in this, an API basically, which is implemented in FreeBSD, in Linux, and in other open source systems where you can easily talk to the USB bus. The bus is scanned regularly. We will see this also. And we have supervised protocol stacks for each gateway. So if this one crashes, this one flashes on. And we also use Erlang distributions. That's actually how I got into Erlang for this device because I was bored. I didn't want to do because it's actually not the first generation of the device. And the first generation I wrote in C, and I wanted to do something different. And I was bored. And we had in the beginning we had devices which had like 16 channels in one device usually. But this was very inflexible for the users because everybody wanted to have a different number of channels. Some want to have one channel only for the lab and four channels for a portable unit which they can take with them and so on. So I thought we make it like cloud flexible. So these devices, they network with themselves. There's a switch inside. You have three Ethernets and you can just daisy chain them. And they find each other, and then they behave like one big box. So you have one big multi-channel box who does the same flashing process on all these channels independently. The other thing of the title is RTEMS, which is a hard real-time small embedded operating system. That's actually the operating system I run in these in the gateways. It's hard real-time, which is actually necessary for some of the automotive protocols. Some of them have hard real-time things in them. It's a very small core. It has a POSIX API. It has a TCP/IP stack if you need them. There are several schedulers to choose from. And it's also like quite aged. It's about the same age as Erlang. And it's also very robust, so it's a very good fit to Erlang. And for example, it runs many satellites and planetary probes. In part of the systems, there are usually lots of subsystems in the planetary probes. And there are also industrial and automotive applications. There's also great support in Europe from the company Embedded Brains, which are actually also clear near to Munich and are friends of mine. Actually, one of them is here today. And which are actually incidentally my hardware developers for the gateway boards, because the gateway boards I have to develop myself. So I usually get the boards with the operating system on them. But that's not why I choose RTEMS. It's just a real nice real-time operating system. So in the HydroProc the HydroProc gateways do the following. They just get the data from the USB and this main gateway also controls, like measures, like the current, and switches on and off the current for the ECU to flash, and it measures the current to be able to auto start. So because you don't have a push button here, like for start, you just connect, and it sees something is connected, something is storing current, and then it talks to it, and the flashing process starts automatically, and. It does all the protocol parts that require hard real time, sure. And yeah, well, it talks to all this low level stuff, which you can't talk from FreeBSD without a bunch of drivers. And it also controls the display LEDs. Blinking lights are actually pretty hard real time. I had a version of the thing which is actually not sold anymore, where the blinking lights were done by Erlang, and which is actually looking very weird, because then you see the soft real time. You are really good to seeing when blinking lights get out of rhythm. And it, you see, when the system is busy, it pauses a little bit in the blink light. And then it blinks very fast because it doesn't miss the events. And it's hard real time. Yeah, so how do we talk to these internal USB devices from Erlang? It's a port, because I didn't trust all this weird USB stuff, so I shoved it off in the port. So if the error handling is also really easy, because everything that can't happen is just an assert in C. So I've moved the let it crash philosophy into the C programming as well. So that eases my error handling, and it works quite neat. I mean, if something happens, it crashes, Erlang starts it again, and it's supervised. You wouldn't notice if it crashes between flashing sessions. It shouldn't crash while it's flashing. There's one problem with USB. It's basically a bus, master-slave bus, and you don't know where is what. So you see all the devices enumerated in any random order. It's not deterministic. It depends on the time they come up on the bus and stuff like this. So you can't depend on it. So you have to have an extra solution. So I have a serial, everything has a serial number, and I have a hardware config file on the Erlang level, and so I can associate which one is the left and the right. So I don't say here in the error message like error on the right side and the left side is red or something like this. And yeah, also USB is weird. If you don't believe me, try it. It's like little endian, and I mean, most protocols in the world are big endian, like network byte order. USB, everything is little endian. The nice thing is, once you have your bulk endpoints, which are basically like a pipe, to your own software on another board established, then it's easy. You just shove bytes through it, and you have flow control. So let's go a little bit into the code. We didn't see any code. Actually, I didn't bring any code, because I thought the first talk would like show you some Erlang code. So no code either. I just brought like diagrams like this. This USB thing is actually that's actually a neat trick that I learned while doing this. The USB bus is scanned regularly, because you can also connect external gateways to it, and also internal gateway might have crashed, or it might have intentionally rebooting because I updated the firmware of the internal gateway. Then it disappears from the bus and reappears, so I have to deal with it. So I dealt with this like in the most flexible way I could do it. I scan the USB bus regularly. I get all this information from the devices. Every device that's interesting to me gets like spawned. Like there's a big gateway supervisor that's one of the error handling, and probably we'll hear in Francesco's talk about supervisors, that watches all the gateways. And each gateway it spawns a temporary sub-supervisor that only has one worker. And that's actually, I put this here because I often see on the mailing list or in the chat that people complain that supervisors don't have enough features, and they want to add another feature to the supervisors, like, I need something like blah, 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 blah. And usually they don't have played enough with supervisors. Like, you can really connect them together like Lego blocks and build really very different behaviors as you wanted. And so that's like advice. If you think your supervisor isn't having the features you want, you're doing it wrong. And the nice thing about this here is, because the problem is, these workers, when the device goes away, they crash a lot. Because I also did the Erlang let it crash way in all these workers. So they crash and they don't get up again, because they try to talk to it again, but they didn't notice that the device is away. You just get an error if you want to talk to the device. So until the next scan comes along, which I do not like every few seconds, this supervisor stays here. So this crashes a lot, and if you don't have this one intermediate supervisor, you would crash your main gateway supervisor, and all the other channels would go away. Because if a supervisor can't start its children, it crashes itself and lets the next level. So, and this is temporary. So this restarting too often crashes this one, But this is temporary, so this one doesn't care. So this just goes away. And the next time the scan comes along, it would be removed anyway, or it wouldn't add it. So just a little bit internals. In these workers, what we need is like we need to talk to the gateway, and we have several units in the gateway where you can where you want to talk to separately, parallel. And so, but we have only one USB, so it's like a demultiplexer here, and here's the port program, and then we have an Erlang handler of the port, and there's also the multiplexer, which actually reads the configuration from the gateway, and actually you can talk to the subsystems on the gateway via name. And yeah, so the protocol layer plumbing, that's actually, I think that's the most complicated part of the thing. What we need is like we need a very flexible protocol layer, because they are doing it differently, and also we have to be able to slip in special modules or configure them differently, because you want to be able to flash control units that are broken. For example, their communication is broken and you need a workaround. Because if you have a few thousands of them which are broken communication and you can't flash them anymore, then it's actually worth something to get a workaround. So I want to do this very flexible. One example, the MOST bus. That's actually the modules in the MOST bus. I picked the most weird one, the most complicated one. So that's basically the top layer. That's UDS, that's basically the diagnostic service. So above this, the actual flashing process is added, like the sequencing, state machines, and stuff like this. And there are all kinds of layers you need to, like you need several network management, network masters and timing masters, because it's synchronous protocol, and you need to segment it.
What does MOST do?
That's the multimedia bus, the optical.
Okay, multimedia.
Like
audio,
basically. Your stereo. If you have a high-end car, then your stereo does this.
Yeah.
And they also have like you need to talk to different chips at the end on the gateway level and use similar but quite a bit different messaging to them. So it splits up here. And I also need a little bit of a CAN stack, because if the CAN network management is not running, then the control unit just sleeps. And if it sleeps, you can't flash it, so you have to talk to it a little bit like reassuringly. And so, and if you want to flash a different ECU, you need a different sequence of these blocks. So I built a layer. These have just ins and outs, and basically, it's basically lambdas, functions. They pass functions up and down for receiving and sending, and they get configured by, yeah, it doesn't look nice, but this few lines configures the whole stack you saw on the page before. So I can configure, and it plugs them together and passes them up and down, and lots of these modules, they don't need state, they are just encoders or decoders. Some have state, so they are just a state loop, like a server loop. Some need only some state, like they need to be told during startup that to do something differently. But I don't want to have a server loop for this, because if I get too many server loops from here below here, then we get this latency thing against us. So we can't afford latency here, actually. And these blocks, if they don't have a state, you can actually pass through. You take the pointer, the function pointer from below, you wrap your own encoder around it, and pass the pointer. I say function pointer. Yeah, I've done too much C in my life. You pass the fun up to the next layer, and it wraps also and also and also. So basically, going from up there until to the next way where there's a state is just a few function calls. But it's fully dynamic. Different thing is how does the data get into the things? I have to speed up a little bit, I think. I'll drop a few topics. The data goes into these things by USB stick. First version did CD-ROMs. because they want to just ship some data to some people somewhere in the world. The software developers make these sticks, and the whole flashing configuration is on these sticks, what the thing should do. So the people who actually set up these boxes, and they just get the USB stick and say, put this in, do your flashing, and then bring us the USB sticks, because the logs go on the USB sticks. And that's basically a global server that started here and distributes the data. On the USB sticks, there's actually something which you might find neat, because there's actually an Erlang app in the USB sticks, but it's signed and encrypted. Also, I mean, it only has to be signed, but it's also encrypted, because they also transport authentication keys to talk to the ECU there in the same thing. And I can also ship extra modules, which are then distributed over the thing. So if I need one special module, I don't need to make a new software for the whole boxes. I just add a few modules on this file they get from me, and it gets shipped dynamically over the network. And there's user data in some script. The user data is basically the flash images, and the script is actually I did it the other way around than most. Some are trying to get Erlang in your syntax. I used the Erlang syntax and used it for something, for scripting language, for flashing. And I did it actually because I was like in a hurry, and I just reused the Erlang parser, and you get the abstract syntax from it, and I just interpret the abstract syntax tree. So that's basically the other way around than Elixir. Yeah, there's also ways to reduce latency. I have a small send expect engines in the gateway, where you can like more streams to the gateway, and it expects something back, and then it can earlier send the stuff. And I'm also working on getting the lib USB thing as a port driver, so into the, as a linked into the VM. So, but I need to get the stability good, that's actually something that might be distributed open source. Also, the protocol plumbing engine, I have to like make it a little bit more general usable, then it might get a open source package. So let's cut through to the lessons learned. Yeah, next time I would use GProc right away. It really messed up my startup. I didn't know about it when I learned Erlang. I learned Erlang while writing the first version of the predecessor of this box. And the startup was much messier than it needed to be, and I should have used GProc. So if you start with Erlang and you make your first later, I'm running out of time. So now I use it for the whole gateway processor. They just tell GProc which serial number they belong to, and then I find the right processors via GProc. Yeah, I mean, well, the quick check thing is a money thing. I mean, it was a money thing there. I couldn't afford it. It looked nice, but I couldn't afford it. But in the meantime, I got a quick check license. And it rocks so much for testing. It brings up my testing productivity, like Erlang brings up my other productivity, my programming productivity. That's what QuickCheck does for you. And I also should have I use common test around QuickCheck. So I actually do it the other way. Actually, I don't use Rebar, and yeah, I should have done OT. I do OTP releases in the meantime. I do it now, but I should have done it earlier. So actually, I'm doing everything in the opposite way than you told us. But on the other hand, I'm in a very different use case. That's not a web thing, and I don't have any text processing, by the way. Except error messages. Yeah, I'm already over time. Do I get a few minutes? It's okay. That's actually the second case. So we're done with this box for now. If you want, you can look inside. I've brought like something. If you want to see real hardware, then we can open it up. The other thing is here. In this box, it's like it's basically collaboration between hot real-time platforms and like a Unix-like platform. So what if we want to build smaller things where we need to integrate on a very small controller hard real-time stuff and soft real-time stuff. Erlang is not very good at hard real-time. Actually, it's not good at all. It's very good at soft real-time. But it can't do hard real-time. It doesn't work. Not even for blinking lights. So, yeah, so we need something different. So I started actually with support of a customer who pays for it. I'm not mentioning them because I don't know if they wanted to be mentioned yet. I ported already to run Erlang on AirTems. So AirTems is a small hard real-time platform, which is basically not an operating system at all, really. It's only a library. It's a scheduler I/O library thing that you link to your executable. So you don't have any memory separation, you don't have any MMUs normally. You can talk to the hardware from each process. In the process, you just go into the registers. You can, like, you would like it. which is actually very neat, and but we have only a very small communication control. It's a Freescale NPC 8309. It has its memory only connected 16-bit wide because 32-bit wide costs too much for embedded systems, and it runs on 200 megahertz. So that's kind of a time travel. But we still want to have best of both worlds. We want the Erlang productivity for embedded systems, which I have learned is very, like, factor 10. I mean, I built the whole thing myself. It wouldn't be possible without Erlang. Not with this amount of functionality. So we want the productivity of Erlang, but we want to have the hard real-time stuff and the getting close to the metal stuff of AirTems. So I ported it. It's work in progress still. Basically, it actually did not move much since Stockholm. I had a lightning talk in Stockholm about this. Because I worked on this project in the meantime, but actually something moved on the AirTems side, which is actually pretty neat. At the moment, I have an Erlang shell on the RS232 console, so I can talk to Erlang. In the meantime, we actually built a prototype for, actually it's an RFID antenna, intelligent RFID antenna system, which, yeah, I can't say more than this at the moment. So the prototype of the RFID antenna was built in Erlang, mostly in Erlang, actually almost talking to the hardware in Erlang, like only very small C layer between the dynamic stuff and the hardware. And it's really neat if you can use the Erlang shell and play with hardware. That's so cool. It's so much fun. And I had the thing running like without reloading my image on the thing with the JTAG debugger for 3 days and just playing around on the Erlang level and implementing the thing. So this worked out. At the moment, we have only LinkedIn drivers, actually LinkedIn drivers which are actually hacked into the VM because there's a static table. Because at this point, we didn't have any dynamic linking support in AirTems, which is really missing because you need that for NIFs and you need that for LinkedIn drivers if you want to have your own and don't want to hack the VM and put your driver into the Erlang VM. So it's cross-built. Just using OTP build, there's a cross-build support in it, which is actually pretty nice. And we're just using the AirTems build tools. And if you link it, the operating system gets linked to it, basically. So if you link it with a tool set, you get the operating system, and then you have one image, which is basically the operating system with the Erlang VM in it. So at the moment, we have file access on the target via NFS only, but that's mainly the reason we didn't get a NAND flash on the target, but only a NOR flash, which is too small for Erlang and AirTems, because the hardware evolved from a time where it was not planned to put Erlang on it. So we have a new version of the hardware with NAND flash, and we are at the moment, the people at Embedded Brains are working probably on it to get me a nice flash file system on it, and I can put my whole O2P, the beam files, on the NAND flash, and then it's self-booting. What we are going to do, what we need to do until this is like a wrap, which actually can be distributed or used outside of my office, EPMD is missing because we don't have like we can't just run EPMD. So I have to I'm actually in the progress of implementing in Erlang, which but you have to shove it into the boot script for the specialist. You have to shove it like early enough that the net kernel already can talk to it. But it's actually it's not much more work missing. Then I can get rid of the RS to the serial console, because then I can just talk to over a remote shell with the embedded target. There is a new thing, the Artemis linker, which is basically came out like in a first version like a few weeks ago, which is basically a way where I can now build the Erlang thing as a kind of dynamicable, loadable application. It's not very dynamic. It's a mix between static and dynamic, as far as I understood it. Is it right? Yeah. So, like you look at it before, and then the symbols. It's really it's a neat. It's hard to describe. It's something different. But I can then build an Erlang VM here, and the RTEMs with the BSP and the drivers and the hardware thing in my application here, the C application, and have two separate things that it gets linked together during loading, basically. And what I also get for free here is with the Artemis linker is dynamic linking support. So I have the DL open and all this stuff that you need to use NIFs and stuff. So I don't have to fake it. Before, I mean, in the last slide in the last version of this slide, there was like faking dynamic linking for supporting NIFs, because without NIFs I can't have SSL, and we want SSL. And also, together, or the people at Embedded Brains, probably this guy, is working or planning to work KQ support, the FreeBSD KQs, which are the asynchronous kernel event thing from FreeBSD that Erlang can actually use into RTEMs. So my goal is, if I have a hardware that talks DMA, so I don't have to like pull bytes of the hardware, that does DMA into the memory and only tells me I have some packets for you here. All I want to, in the interrupt driver, in the real hardware interrupt service routine, I want to send a KQ event, and the next thing that runs is the Erlang VM and gets the KQ event. Because that will get rid of all the operating system latency to the hardware. And this will have very nice properties, I think. Because we get even closer than Erlang on Xen to the hardware, because we are talking with real hardware. Yeah. Yeah. Well, in the future, it's I try to do it that I'm able to get all the packages the patches back to RTEMs and OTP. So ideally, you only need a README, or maybe a script, and then you can build the RTEMs tools with the Erlang tools, because I don't want to maintain like patch sets that I have to update every time OTP updates and RTEMs updates. And yeah, that will be basically, it will be open source this way. Yeah, but once we get SMP, it's probably very tempting to get it in Erlang support too. But RTEMs is in progress to get real SMP. In progress? Is it?
Progress.
Yeah, good. Yeah, I'm over time, but questions, as long as Monica lets you. Yes.
You said that Erlang is bad for hard real-time, and you basically pointed to the performance on the FreeBSD kernel, and then you have Erlang now on the RTEMS kernel, and then it's fine? So the problem is not really Erlang, but laying up on top of FreeBSD?
No. I made a few shortcuts because I was out of time. The real hard real-time stuff, you do in RTEMS, because it's a hard real-time operating system. So you have hard real-time tasks that have a higher priority.
So that's in C?
In C,
okay.
Yeah, that have a higher priority than the Erlang VM, so they always preempt the Erlang VM.
Okay.
And the Erlang VM does its soft real-time thing very good. I mean, Erlang is not bad at hard real-time, it can't do it. It's very good at soft real-time. And that you need also. I mean, the real world systems are basically so much hard real time if at all, and then a bigger pile of soft real-time and then non-real-time stuff.
Yeah, but what is missing? I mean, what's missing? I mean, in the end, real-time is always about being fast enough.
Yeah, hard real-time means it's an error if it's not in time.
Yeah.
It's like the red light goes on, the nuclear reactor goes boom if you're late. That's hard real-time.
So what's lacking? Is it lacking priorities?
I mean, even with the pair process schedulers of Erlang, you only get very good soft real-time, but you can always have a garbage collection or something happening. It's a different thing. But the hard real-time stuff is usually very, very easy also. It's very small software, usually. And that's my goal, to have the minimum in C. I mean, I like C for stuff like this. The minimum in C, so many code that I can look at it and understand it. And all the rest in Erlang.
But there's also this Erlang VM now on Xen, which is also more or less getting rid of the operating system underneath that might...
Yeah, it's using Xen as an operating system.
Yeah.
They're cheating. Oh. I mean, it's a virtual machine.
Yes.
I'm talking about real machines, like the real bits in the machine, the real interrupt, not the virtual interrupt. So they are always one layer away from the real machine, and they have a totally different use case, which is also nice. But it's not bare metal. Not my bare metal. Mm-hmm. Pablo?
No.
The thing about the real time is really like you have to compute ahead of time how long it will take to process things, right? Is it only the garbage collection kicking in that is undeterministic, or is it other things too?
Actually, I didn't think about it because once we have this running, that in theory, if the operating system is not coming into the way for hard real time, then we can think about what can we do in Erlang. Maybe we can do a hard real time process in Erlang and try to avoid garbage collections in having a high priority, stuff like this. There are ways to harden the soft real time then, but that's future.
One point of your confusion was that you should have used SheepFrog right from the beginning. Could you briefly explain what SheepFrog is about?
SheepFrog is unfortunately not part of the OTP libraries. It's an external part, but almost official. it's a process registry. And there are a few process registries built into the OTP where you can register a process by name. Locally and globally and stuff like this, but they have different uses because you can only have atomset names. You can't have like a tuple where I say this is the main gateway serial number such and such, and I want to register over any data, and GPROC does this. It's basically a big ETS table where all the processor registers. It's basically the thing you will write yourself. When your system gets bigger, you want to register your processes somewhere with different data. And, Ulf did it already. Don't do it yourself. Just take it. It's fine. I don't use it for global. I use Erlang Global for global, which is slower but more robust for global. But for local, I use GPROC.
Try
it
properly instead of
QuickCheck? One customer paid me a QuickCheck license, so why should I?
Okay.
I even get support. I think is, if you're doing a commercial operation, I mean, a QuickCheck license is not cheap, but if you're doing a commercial operation and you're earning money with it, and for the productivity you get, it's cheap.
And Broker is a three-month hack by a very bright student. QuickCheck is probably two professors putting and lots of PhDs.
I never compared it.
That's for PhD who have worked on it for maybe 10 years. So it's...
I think Broker is nice for open source projects.
Broker is perfect to get started.
Yeah.
But if you want to do serious things, then go over to QuickCheck. If you want to do the hard stuff, that's QuickCheck.
It really changes your way of testing completely. Like Erlang changes your way of development completely. And it's nice that you have it together. And for example, with QuickTJ, I only can check the C code in my gateways, which proper can't. You can't check C code. Do we have more time? There's one more question.
Your device performs flashes for
this one.
This one, yes, for chips that are probably safety relevant in the car.
Oh yeah.
So you have to verify that the flash process is okay.
Oh yes.
Yes. How can you do it for?
That depends. I mean, if the car manufacturer already noticed that it's very relevant what's in the flash of their ECUs, which not all did, I've seen things. I'm not saying who. They have cryptographically signed software units. So there's a signature check. After I flash, I have to trigger a signature check in the control unit. And then you have a RSA signature check with an MD5 or something, some SHA over the whole image, which takes some time. And I can rely on this normally. So if I get through this process, I'm safe. I have other things where if I flash over APIX, I have also APIX gateway, where I actually talk directly to the chip in the ECU. Then I just read it out and compare it.
Okay.
There's no way around this.
So you verify the result of the process?
I verify everything. I verify the process with testing, and because the process is always the same.
Yeah.
And if I don't have something like the signature check, I have to read it out again.
Okay.
Everything else is insane. If the customer says it's flashing is taking too long because you read it out again everything, then I say, be serious. Okay? Thank you.